California, 1941.
The house was on Dresden Avenue in Pasadena. A big, solid, cool-looking house with half an acre or so of fine green lawn drifting down to the street. At the door, on a concrete block, was a little painted Negro in white riding breeches and a green jacket and a red cap. He was holding a whip and there was an iron hitching ring in the block at his feet. He looked a little sad, as if he'd been waiting there a long time and was getting discouraged. So I went over and patted his head while I was waiting for somebody to come to the door. A middle-aged maid let me in. It hurt her to have me in her clean house. She took me to a room furnished as an office.
Can I help you? I'm Miss Davis, Mrs. Murdoch's secretary.
I'm Philip Marlowe, calling on Mrs. Elizabeth Bright Murdoch by appointment.
Oh, first of all, Mr. Marlowe... sit down, please.
Thanks.
First of all, Mrs. Murdoch wanted me to ask you for a few references.
References?
Certainly. References. Does that surprise you?
You mean she hired me as a private detective without knowing anything about me?
She got your name from the manager of a branch of the California Security Bank, but he doesn't know you personally.
Get your pencil ready. A vice president of the same bank, George S. Leak. Then State Senator Houston Oglethorpe. He may be in Sacramento, or he may be at his office in the State Building in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. Sidney Dreyfus Jr. of Dreyfus, Turner & Swain, attorneys, in the Title Insurance Building. Got that?
Yeah.
Oliver Fry of the Fry-Krantz Corporation over on East 9th. Then, if you would like a couple of cops, Bernard Oles of the DA's staff, and Detective Lieutenant Carl Randell of the Central Homicide Bureau. You think maybe that would be enough?
Don't laugh at me. I'm only doing what I'm told.
Better not call the last two unless you know what the job is. I'm not laughing at you. Hot, isn't it?
It's not hot for Pasadena. Excuse me.
While she was telephoning hither and yon, I looked her over. Her blondish hair was drawn back so tightly over her narrow head that it almost lost the effect of being hair at all. Her chin looked unstable. The whole face had a sort of off-key neurotic charm that only needed some clever makeup to be striking. She didn't wear any. When she finished her call, she asked me to wait and went out. I went round her desk, looked in the drawers. It wasn't any of my business, I was just curious. It wasn't any of my business that she had a small Colt automatic in the drawer. I shut the drawer and waited to be taken into the presence of Mrs. Murdoch.
Mr. Marlowe, would you come this way?
Mrs. Murdoch reclined on a chaise lounge with a glass of port in her hand and the bottle handy at her elbow. She had a lot of face and chin. She had pewter-colored hair set in a ruthless permanent, a hard beak, and large, moist eyes with the sympathetic expression of wet stones. There was lace at her throat, but it was the kind of throat that would have looked better in a football sweater. She let me stand while she finished her glass and filled it again.
Sit down, Mr. Marlowe. Please do not light that cigarette. I'm asthmatic. I've never had any dealings with private detectives. And what are your charges?
To do what, Mrs. Murdoch?
It's a very confidential matter, naturally.
I charge $25 a day and, of course, expenses.
It seems high.
No, it isn't. I'm just one man and I work at just one case at a time. I take risks. Sometimes quite big risks. And I don't work all the time. Of course, you can get detective work done at any price.
And what is the nature of your expenses?
Little things that come up here and there. You never know.
I should prefer to know.
You'll have a chance to object.
And how much retainer would you expect?
$100 would hold me.
I should hope it would.
From people in your position, Mrs. Murdoch, I don't necessarily have to have a retainer.
Mr. Marlowe, I'm a strong-minded woman. But don't let me scare you. Because if you can be scared by me, you won't be much use to me. My asthma. I drink this wine as a medicine. That's why I'm not offering you any.
Sure.
Now, here is the situation. Something of considerable value has been stolen from me. I want it back, but I don't want anybody arrested. The thief happens to be a member of my family by marriage, my daughter-in-law. A charming girl, tough as an oak board. I have a damn fool of a son, but I'm very fond of Leslie. About a year ago, he made an idiotic marriage without my consent. This was foolish of him because he is quite incapable of earning a living, and he has no money except what I give him, and I am not generous with money.
Who is the lady?
A nightclub singer called, appropriately enough, Linda Conquest. They lived here. We didn't quarrel because I don't allow people to quarrel with me in my own house. I pay their expenses. No doubt the lady found life rather dull. No doubt she found my son dull. I find Leslie dull myself. At any rate, she moved out abruptly a week ago without a forwarding address or a goodbye.
And you say she took something?
A coin. A rare gold coin. Called a brasher doubloon. The pride of my late husband's collection. It is a mint specimen. Said to be worth over $10,000.
But pretty hard to sell.
I didn't miss the coin until yesterday. I should not have missed it then, as I never go near the collection. Except that a man called Morning Star called up. Said he was a dealer and was the coin for sale. I was curious.
Why?
If the man was a dealer of any repute, he would know that the coin was not for sale. My husband provided in his will that no part of the collection might be removed from this house. I told Mr. Morningstar as much and hung up. Then I went upstairs and found the coin had gone from its locked case.
Just what do you want done?
In the first place, I want the coin back. In the second place, I want an uncontested divorce for my son, and I don't intend to buy it. I dare say you know how these things are arranged.
I may have heard. I'll have to talk to your son.
Leslie knows nothing. Not even that the doubloon has been stolen. I don't want him to know. When the time comes, I'll handle him. He will do exactly what I want him to.
Oh, he hasn't always.
His marriage was momentary impulse.
It takes 3 days to have that kind of impulse in California, Mrs. Murdoch.
Young man, do you want this job or don't you?
If I'm told the facts and allowed to handle the case as I see fit.
This is a delicate family matter. It must be handled with delicacy.
If you hire me, you'll get all the delicacy I have. But I take it you don't want your daughter-in-law framed. I'm not delicate enough for that.
You'll do, Mr. Marlowe.
Well, I'll need a photo of the lady and some information.
In the desk drawer. I know almost nothing about Linda. She once shared an apartment with another entertainer, Lois Magic. They worked together at a place called the Idle Valley Club, owned by a man named Morney, I believe. Leslie knows it far too well. I will ask him if he knows the address of this Lois Magic.
Oh, this lady is quite a looker. One thing, if I find that the lady did not steal the coin, that ends this investigation as far as I'm concerned.
She stole it all right, and I don't intend to let her get away with it. Paste that in your hat, young man. And I hope you are even half as rough as you like to act, because these nightclub girls are apt to have some very nasty friends.
Oh, I like them nasty. The nasty ones have simple minds. Well, I'll report to you when there is anything to report, Mrs. Murdoch.
You don't like me very much, do you?
Does anybody? Hey, Miss Davis, cheer up. You shouldn't feel sorry for yourself. You should feel sorry for her. She thinks she's tough and she's trying to break her back, trying to live up to it. There's no need to cry.
Oh, don't touch me, please. I never let men touch me. And don't say those Mrs. Murdoch. I only want to do my best for her.
Yeah. What do you know about a Miss Lois Magic?
She only came here once with Mr. Vanier.
What does she look like?
Blonde, very, very appealing.
You mean sexy?
Well, in a nice, well-bred sort of way, if you know what I mean. Yeah,
I know what you mean, but I never got anywhere with it.
I can believe that.
Oh. You know where Miss Magic lives?
No. Mr. Marlowe, I wouldn't carry that tough guy manner too far if I were you. And I can't answer any more questions. My position here is very confidential.
I'm not tough, just virile.
Perhaps I don't like virile men.
You're a screwball if ever I met one. As I went out, I patted the little Negro on the head again.
Brother,
it's even worse than I expected. When I left there, I was followed by a small sand-colored coupe with a fat man wearing a pork pie-type straw hat with a tropical print band. I got rid of him and went on down to my two rooms in the Kangma building. The reception room was empty of customers. It was empty of everything but the smell of dust. It had been for too long. I went into my office. Three hard chairs, a swivel chair, desk, five filing cases, three of them full of nothing, a calendar, a framed license, phone, hat rack, carpet, and two open windows with net curtains that puckered in and out like the lips of a toothless old man sleeping. The same stuff I had last year and the year before that. Not beautiful, but better than a tent on the beach.
Come in.
You're Marlowe?
Yeah.
I'm a little disappointed. I rather expected something with dirty fingernails.
Come on in, and you could be witty sitting down.
Thank you.
All set? Pulse and respiration normal? You wouldn't like a cold towel on your head or anything?
A private detective. A shifty business, one gathers. Keyhole peeping, raking up scandal, that sort of thing.
You here on business or just slumming?
My name is Leslie Murdoch. I understand my mother has employed you on a job of some sort.
Has she?
Yes. A little worm told me. Often trodden on, but still somehow surviving, like myself. You were hired to find my wife, aren't you? Marlowe, I'll try very hard, but I don't think I'm going to like you.
I'm screaming with rage and pain.
Why should my mother want Linda found? Why should she pay? My mother hates to spend money. She thinks money is part of her skin.
Who said she did?
But you implied... Merle said...
Merle talks out of turn.
You wouldn't tell Mother. Anyhow, Mother couldn't do without Merle. She has to have somebody to bully. She might yell at her or even slap her face, but she couldn't do without her. Look, Marlowe, please be reasonable and give me an idea what it's all about. Would a couple of hundred make any...
What? I ought to bop you. If a man in my line of work is handed a job, does he go around answering questions about it to anyone that gets curious?
For a man in your line of work to turn down $200, there must be a lot of electricity in the air. Listen, Marlowe, I love my wife. I know she doesn't love me. She hasn't really had a lot of fun being married to me.
You're just too modest.
Maybe it's not Linda. Maybe it's something else. Maybe it's Morny.
Maybe it is.
I didn't think Mother knew about that. Did he call her? He promised not to.
Just how much are you into him for?
I owe him 12,000.
What kind of a lad is Morny? Tough?
I suppose he is. He used to be in pictures, screen heavy. Linda just sang at his Idle Valley Club, you know. And if you are looking for her, you'll have a hard time finding her.
She's not buried in the backyard, I hope.
Will this show you I'm serious?
You'd better get a bigger gun, Leslie. That thing wouldn't shoot bees.
Get this straight. If anybody tries to push Linda around, he'll have to push me around first.
Tuck the gun back in your garter.
Oh, it's a waste of time talking to you. All you do is wisecrack. I'm going.
Well, I'll see you out.
Afraid I'll steal your antiques?
I don't think you are worried about your wife. I think you know where she is. She didn't run away from you. She ran away from your mother. Perhaps she'll get a job and make enough money to support you.
You bastard!
If you want to hit somebody, do yourself a favor and pick a midget. An old midget.
Let me go.
How come your old man didn't leave you any money?
If it's any of your rotten business, Jasper Murdoch was not my father. My father was a man named Horace Bright, who lost all his money in the crash and jumped out of his office window. Now, if you're satisfied, I'll be on my way.
I'm doing you a favor. A gun toter oughtn't to insult so easily. You better ditch it.
I'm sorry I took a swing at you. Probably wouldn't have hurt much if it had connected.
Oh, that's all right. I was on my way to see Lois Magic, and I was being followed again by the straw hat with the print band. This time he was wearing dark glasses. That made him invisible. He wasn't hard to shake off. A friend of mine at the Chronicle had done a little research. Lois Magic had not long ago become Mrs. Alex Morney, and he had bought a house up in Bel Air, a neighborhood in which nobody walked, not even the postman. The house was modest enough, not more than 14 rooms, and probably only one swimming pool. At the side of the house, a chauffeur, who looked like an overgrown jockey, was washing a Cadillac. According to him, nobody was home. I showed him my card.
Ah, private dick, huh? How's a little old expense account?
Fat, with inactivity.
Well, for $5, I could start thinking.
I wouldn't want to make it that tough for you. All I want to know is whether Mrs. Morney is home. Does that rate more than a buck?
You ain't working for Morney, are you?
Sure.
You're a liar.
Sure.
$2.
You have them.
Ah, she's in the backyard with a friend. A nice friend named Vanier. I mean, you get a friend that don't work and a husband that works, you're all set, see?
You'll be all set in an irrigation ditch one of these days.
Not me, Jack. I'm wise. I know how to play them. I monkeyed around these kind of people all my life. Don't worry about lover boy, but watch out for the poodle. Name of Heathcliff.
Wuthering Heights?
Talk English, Jack.
Vanier was the Latin lover type. He and Lois Magic lay out by the pool with the scotch bottle and the ice bucket handy. From 30 feet away, she looked like a lot of class. From 10 feet away, she looked like something made up to be seen from 30 feet away. Relax, Heathcliff. Hey, go find Kathy.
Heathcliff! Heathcliff, come here at once.
He likes the man. I like what I see, too.
Who the hell are you? What do you mean, busting in here? Weren't you told there was no one in?
Yeah, but I didn't believe it. Are you, Mr. Morney?
No, I'm, just a friend.
Sit down and rest your sex appeal, Lou. Who are you, handsome?
Philip Marlowe. I'm a private detective.
Big, aren't you? Too much for you to handle, I guess, Lou.
All right, Marlowe. Get it over with, whatever it is.
Do I talk to her, or do I talk to you and have you put it in English, huh?
What do you want?
You shared an apartment once with a girl called Linda Conquest. I'm looking for her.
I don't think I've seen her in 6 months. She got married. What do you want to know for, big boy?
Just a private inquiry.
About what?
A confidential matter.
And that gives you the right to bust in here?
So, you don't know where she is, Mrs. Morney?
She just said so.
She said she didn't think she'd seen her.
Who's looking for her?
Her folks.
Guess again. She doesn't have any folks.
Well, you must know her pretty well if you know that.
You got your answer. You're not wanted here.
I think you can tell me where she is, Mrs. Morney, if you want to.
How are you going to make me want to,
With all these people around, how can I?
Well, that's a thought.
Get out, mug, while you can still walk.
Where's your refinement? And don't tell me you wear a gun under your Cesar Romero outfit, or have you got an itch?
Don't write me off too quick. I'd plug you as soon as I'd strike a match. And I'd fix it afterwards.
Don't get so hostile, darling.
Tell him to go.
It would take you a week to get a gat out from under that shirt if you have one. I'll come back when you're ready. So long, Heathcliff. When I stopped off at the office on my way downtown to see Mr. Morningstar, the coin dealer, Straw Hat started tailing me again. So I went into a hotel and bought some cigarettes I didn't need and sat down in the lobby. He was right behind me. He was young and pink and plump. He sat down and gave the lobby the benefit of his eagle eye. So I wandered over and sat beside him. Hi.
Yeah? Have I Seen you somewhere before?
Only over in Pasadena this morning and now this afternoon.
Oh. I guess I must be lousy.
Boy, you stink.
Maybe it's the hat. It's a pretty tough dollar in this town. You ruin yourself with taxi fares, or if you use your own car, you have to stay too close.
You don't have to climb into the guy's pocket. Did you want something with me?
I figured to find out if you were smart enough to be worth talking to.
I'm very smart. It would be a shame not to talk to me.
That's my card. George Anson Phillips, confidential investigator. I used to be a deputy up at Ventura. I knew you when you were working on the Gregson case 6 years ago, remember?
No.
Oh. Well, when I saw the guy go into your office, I figured he had hired you.
Which guy?
Leslie Murdoch. I'm working for his wife. I figured we might pool our resources, maybe make a deal.
Divorce?
So she says. But I wonder. I don't like it. Can we talk?
Oh, I have an appointment now.
Come to my apartment after. I'll write it down. It's Court Street. On Bunker Hill. Sorry, I haven't been in the chips lately. Listen. A very tall guy has been tailing me. Well, not now, though. Anything to do with you?
No. Just to make sure. Your client, she's a tall blonde with careless eyes, huh?
Well, I wouldn't call them careless.
And just between the two of us, this divorce stuff is a lot of hooey. It's something else, isn't it?
Something I don't like more every minute I think about it. Here. Don't wait around if I'm out. This is the key to my place. What time will you be there?
About 4:30. You sure you want to give me this key?
Well, why not? We're in the same racket.
Yeah. So we are. The Belfont building, where Morningstar had his office, had only one elevator working. In it sat an old man on a piece of burlap folded on top of a wooden stool. He looked as if he had been sitting there since the Civil War and had come out of that badly.
Okay, Pop.
I hear in New York they got elevators that just whiz, do 20 floors at a time. That's New York.
Ah, the hell with New York. I like it here.
Must take a good man to run them fast babies.
All those cuties do is push buttons. But take a Model T job like this. Takes a man to run it.
Yeah. Morningstar, at the back.
Thanks for your help, Pop. Keep breathing.
What can I do for you, Mr. Marlowe?
Tell me about the Brasher doubloon, Mr. Morningstar.
It's an interesting coin. Among the most valuable of early American coins. It's gold, about the size of a half dollar. Made for the state of New York in 1787. It was not minted. There were no mints till 1793, so it was pressure molded by a private goldsmith named Ephraim Brasher, or Brashear.
What's the pressure molding process?
Well, the two halves of the mold were engraved in steel, mounted in lead, and a gold blank pressed between them.
Slow process.
And not exact. Always slight variations. So it would be safe to say, by modern methods of microscopic identification, no two coins would be identical.
How many of these coins are there?
Nobody knows. Perhaps 1,000. But very few in mint condition. They're the valuable ones.
How valuable?
Handled by a reputable dealer with a history of the coin, $10,000.
And without history?
Rare coins do turn up in odd places, but not often. With the coin you mentioned, the implication of theft would be strong. That's $5, please.
Huh?
But don't be absurd, Mr. Marlowe. Everything I've told you is available in the public library. Now, you've taken up my time relating it to you. That's $5.
Okay, $5. There you are. Now, Mr. Morningstar, let's talk about the Brasher doubloon that somebody tried to sell you.
Oh? Did somebody? And why would they want to do that?
They needed the money. They knew your office was in a shabby dump at the end of a corridor, and you were an elderly man who would probably not make any false moves out of regard for your health?
And you assume all this from the mere fact that I telephoned Mrs. Murdoch and asked if her Brasher doubloon was for sale?
You knew it wasn't for sale. You would know the Murdoch collection and the terms of the will. But when it was offered to you, you wanted to buy it.
Why?
As a reputable dealer, you would be protecting the owner or her insurance from complete loss of the stolen item, and they'd gladly pay you for the favor of getting it back.
How much would the owner pay?
$1,000. What did you pay?
$800. For a mint uncirculated Brasher doubloon, $800. you're a very smart young man.
Yeah, let's have the coin.
You take me for a fool? It's not my office. Come back at 11 tomorrow with the money. Have it in used bills. Used 20s will do. An occasional 50 will do no harm.
What did she look like?
Who?
The girl who sold you the coin.
Oh, where? He was middle-aged. Heavy set, 5'7", about 170 pounds. Said his name was Smith. Blue suit, green shirt, no hat, brown handkerchief in his outer pocket, hair dark. A scar 2 inches long down the side of his jaw. Left side.
What about the hole in his right sock?
I omitted to take his shoes off.
Damn careless of you.
Don't think that I don't know how to protect myself, Mr. Marlowe.
I hope you do, because what you're handling is dynamite. I left Morningstar smiling. What I did next was a cheap trick, a sucker play. But it worked because his secretary was out. I tramped off and then sneaked back into his outer office and listened on her extension. He called a Mr. Anson in Court Street, Bunker Hill, who wasn't in. The same Court Street where lived the pink and innocent George Anson Phillips, who had been hired by a tall blonde, when in her picture, Linda Conquest had dark hair, and who had given me his key because he was worried and wanted to see me. Court Street.
Frankie and Johnny.
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
The couple across the hall from Philip's apartment were enjoying themselves. They hadn't seen me. They didn't know what day of the week it was. I felt sick. The apartment had seemed empty till I pushed at the bathroom door, which stuck, and then I smelled the smell. Phillips was crumbled up and jammed into the little room. He had a bloody bruise on the right side of his head, and his mouth was full of blood. I kept smelling the cordite fumes. I rubbed off any prints of mine and got out. There was nothing for me here. I was a fool even to look at the manager's sign. I should have got out.
Yeah? What you want?
Anson, room 204 upstairs. He's not in.
What should I do? Lay an egg? Beat it. Drift.
$5.
Look, I run a nice, respectable place here. Who are you?
That's my card.
Pollock. Insurance. I didn't figure Anson for no crook. Hell, they come in all shapes and sizes. Don't have been here a month. If it looked like a wrong G, wouldn't have been here at all.
What say we frisk the apartment while he's out?
Mr. Palermo wouldn't like it.
Who's he?
He owns the building, a lot of others. Practically owns the district. It's the vote out, you know. Not a guy to crowd.
Okay. Let's go up and frisk the apartment.
Don't get me sore at you.
That would bother me like 2 cents of nothing. Let's go up and frisk the apartment.
You said something about a five?
That was hours ago. Let's go up and frisk the apartment.
Look, I was sitting here having myself a beer or two or nine, what the hell. I wasn't bothering anybody. Looked like it might be a nice evening. And then you come in.
Let's go up and frisk the apartment.
If it's the only way to get you out of here, let's go.
Yeah?
Right down. Tony, too much racket. Next time I call the law.
Hey, Hans.
What?
The guy says to pipe down. Do you want to sock him?
Hey, you. Buzz off. I just come in from lunch. I had a lousy lunch. I wouldn't want nobody to push muscle at me.
You heard me, Hench. Dim that radio and make it sudden.
Why, you...
Very neat with the blackjack.
Why, thank you.
He's going for a gun under his pillow.
Yeah, I can fade that, too.
Fast draw.
Thank you.
Hey.
Drop the gun, Hench.
Hey. This ain't my gun. Mine's a Colt 32. This ain't my gun. Look, look.
Allow me.
Go ahead.
Let's see it.
This ain't my gun.
This has been fired recently.
That's an automatic. It ain't my gun.
A shot has been fired from this, and there's a dead man across the hall.
What?
Better get some law.
Phillips was shot in the throat with a medium-caliber gun and a soft-nosed bullet. A gun like this and bullets like is in here. Now tell me again, Hench.
Lieutenant, it ain't my gun.
Then how did it get under your pillow?
We went out about 3:30 to get something to eat. You can check that at the hash house. We must have left the door unlocked.
Tell me about the gun.
I had a gun, yeah, but it was a revolver, not an automatic. It had a piece broken off the rubber grip. Somebody swiped my gun and left that one. You gotta believe me.
You saw him take this gun from under the pillow, Marlowe?
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Hanson, now say the radio killed the noise of the shot and you had left your door open. The killer hears you go out.
Yeah.
And he wants to ditch the gun, so he walks into your apartment and slips it under your pillow. And then, imagine his surprise, he finds another gun, your gun, there waiting for him.
The one with the broken grip, yeah.
So he swaps. Now why, huh? Why take the risk? Why the fancy pants?
You don't have any boys who can bounce me hard enough to make me tell it different. I need a drink. I need a drink bad. Oh, geez, I wish I could remember better.
Well, we're going to have to hold you until we trace your gun. Lieutenant Spangler will take you downtown.
Hey, get on up, babe. We got to take a ride.
Huh?
She needs a drink.
Let's go.
Come on, babe.
Oh, you bum.
Yeah.
Let's go.
All right.
Well, you and me, Marlowe, are going to get along.
Oh, that's fine, Lieutenant.
Jesse's the name. Jesse Breeze. Look, I haven't taken a sudden fancy to you. It's the way I work. Everything quiet, everything in the clear.
You don't think he shot Phillips?
Look, I just got here. What's the idea of using the name Pollock?
Well, in a neighborhood like this, it's bad form to use your own name.
Why come here at all? What do you know about the dead guy?
I told you.
Look, you don't have to be stuck with it. You could always give us a better story. Okay, he follows you, you brace him, and as a result of this little lobby conversation, this guy, a total stranger to you, asks you to his apartment and hands you his key because he wants to talk to you.
Yes.
Why couldn't he talk to you then?
I had a business appointment.
Just what are you working on?
I can't tell you.
Look, this is a murder case. You're going to have to tell me.
I'm sorry, Breeze. I'm not convinced of that yet.
You know I can throw you in the can as a material witness?
Are you going to do it?
Why don't you go home and let a man work, huh? But don't leave town. We'll want a statement. Maybe tonight.
It was 6:45 when I let myself into my office and found the package. I poured myself a drink and sat there holding the neck of the cool bottle, wondering how it would feel to be a homicide dick and find bodies lying around and not mind at all. Not have to sneak out wiping doorknobs. Not have to ponder how much I could tell without hurting a client, and how little I could tell without too badly hurting myself. I decided I wouldn't like it. The package had my name and address neatly hand-printed in ink. It was a cardboard box full of cotton wool, and inside that a bright gold coin about the size of a half dollar. The date was 1787, and in small letters at the bottom of one side was the name Brasher. I was looking at the Brasher doubloon. There was no note with it, nothing. I slipped it down with the tobacco in my pouch, got a shoulder holster out of my desk and strapped on a Colt 38 automatic and was ready to leave.
Too bad for you, Marlowe.
Mrs. Murdoch's residence?
Merle, you oughtn't to have told him.
Who?
Your friend, Leslie. You shouldn't have told him. She hired me.
How dare you suggest that, Mr. Marlowe?
Let me talk to Mrs. Murdoch.
Where are you?
In a drugstore, in a very hot phone booth.
Wait a moment.
I need air.
This is Mrs. Murdoch.
Mrs. Murdoch, could you identify the doubloon?
I suppose so. I don't know.
The dealer, Morningstar, claims to have seen it. I'm going to call on him now. He says it was offered to him for sale, just as you suspected.
I see.
He won't say who offered it, but it may have been a fellow called George Anson Phillips, who claims to be a private eye. Do you know him?
Why should I? Get to the point, Marlowe.
I've agreed to pay $1,000 for the return of the article, if you want me to do that.
This is all very unnecessary now, Marlowe. You see, the coin has been returned to me.
What? Hold the wire.
What is going on?
A rat was gnawing my foot, that's all. You got it back. How?
I may explain, and I may not. You may call on me tomorrow. The investigation is closed.
Things have happened, Mrs. Murdoch.
Tell me tomorrow. Goodbye.
You all right, sir?
A double scotch on the rocks, no ice.
This is a drugstore, sir, not a bar.
Huh? Oh, yeah, yeah, so it is. I mean, so it isn't. I've had a shock, pal. Give me a cup of weak coffee and a thin ham sandwich on stale bread. No, I better not eat yet either. Goodbye.
Hollywood's full of them.
I was sitting at home over a chess problem with a drink at my elbow and nothing on my mind, except two murders. Morningstar was dead when I got to his office. He had been hit on the head, and the violet color of his face showed that he had died of a heart stoppage. But that didn't make it any less murder. So I wiped the doorknobs, walked back past the dental technicians and the typewriting service, and hoped the old elevator man was as vacant as he looked. And then I called the receiving hospital, giving no name. Then I hocked the doubloon I'd been sent in a pawn shop for safekeeping, wondering all the time how Mrs. Murdoch had got it back while I had it in my pocket, and why two men had to die, and I had to find them and go home. Oh, what brings you here, Lieutenant?
Take a look around, Spangler.
Yes, sir.
Close the door, Marlowe.
There's nobody here. I live alone.
You don't mind if we look? Spangler?
Nobody here.
Satisfied? Let me show you out.
We didn't come here to get tough, Marlowe.
Oh, that's fine. So you prowl all around my apartment without asking my permission. What do you do when you get tough? Knock me down and kick me?
Murder ain't funny, Marlowe.
Who said it was?
You play a lot of chess?
That's just a game I've set out. Once in a while, I fool around with a game, thinking things out.
Don't it take two guys to play chess?
I play over tournament games that have been recorded and published. There's a whole literature about chess. Once in a while, I work out problems. Well, you may as well sit down.
Oh, thanks. I did a little checking about you. Lieutenant Randall tells me you're on the level.
Oh, that's friendly of him.
He says you make good coffee and you get up kind of late and are apt to run to a very bright line of chatter. And that we should believe anything you say, provided we can check it by five independent witnesses. You know, I like everything in the clear. That's why I'm telling you. I just hope you've told me everything.
Why should I? You don't pay my salary.
Don't get tough.
I don't have any idea of being tough.
Let's talk about murder. Huh?
Okay.
The murder of...
George Anson Phillips.
And?
That's our murder.
Now, you said you didn't know why he wanted to see you. Now, we figured that maybe with time to think back, you could remember.
In other words, I was lying.
We just want you to make sense.
Why give the manager a phony card and get him to go up with you when you've already found the body?
It pays to be cagey in those places. I thought he might know something, that's all.
We know Phillips was on a job as a private dick, like you. You're on a job. Now, if those jobs tie up, that's our business.
Now, don't forget, this is a murder case.
I've been around this town more than 15 years. I've seen murder cases come and go. Some have been solved. Some couldn't be solved. And some could have been solved that were not solved. And one or two, or three, have been solved wrong. Maybe you've forgotten the Cassidy case.
Look, I'm tired. Let's stick to the Phillips case.
I'm going to make a point, and it's an important point. Cassidy was a very rich man, a multimillionaire. He had a grown-up son. One night, the cops were called to his home. Young Cassidy was on his back with a bullet hole in the side of his head, and his male secretary was lying in the adjoining bathroom with a gun by his right hand. He, too, had been shot in the head, but it was not a contact wound. A lot of drinking had been done. 4 hours had elapsed since the deaths, and the family doctor called in by the father had been there for 3 of those hours. Now, what did the cops do with the Cassidy case?
Murder and suicide during a drinking spree. The secretary went haywire and shot young Cassidy. Is that what you want me to say?
That's what the paper said. But the cops knew it wasn't so, and the DA knew, and the DA's investigators were pulled off the case. Everybody knew young Cassidy was the one who was crazy drunk, that the secretary tried to handle him and couldn't, and that Cassidy did the shooting, then shot himself. Cassidy's was the contact wound. And what were Rich Daddy and the family doctor doing for those 4 hours they didn't call the cops? Why were no tests made on the hands? Because you didn't want the truth. Cassidy was too big, but this was a murder case too, wasn't it?
The guys were both dead. What the hell difference does it make? Who shot who?
Did you ever stop and think that the secretary might have had a mother or a sister or a sweetheart? That they had their pride and their faith and their love for a kid who was made out to be a drunk and paranoid killer just because his boss had $100 million? What difference does it make?
Make your point.
Until you guys own your own souls, you don't own mine. Until you guys can be trusted every time and always, in all times and conditions, to seek the truth and find it and let the chips fall where they may, until that time comes, I have a right to listen to my conscience and protect my client the best way I can. Until I'm sure you won't do him more harm than you do the truth good. Or until I'm hauled before somebody who can make me talk.
You sound to me just a little like a guy who is trying to hold his conscience down.
Hell, leave it. Let's have a drink.
Well, this one won't do no harm. Spangler, get some ice for the man.
Hey, say, I'd like to read up on that Cassidy case. Sounds interesting. Must have been before my time.
It never happened.
You're kidding me?
Yeah.
Oh. I'll get the ice.
What did you find out about Phillips's background?
Kind of a pathetic case, that kid. The sheriff up at Ventura said he did what they told him to do, and he'd do it pretty well, provided they told him which foot to start on and how many steps to take which way and little things like that. But he didn't develop much, if you get what I mean. So the sheriff let George go. He knocked around for a while, had a few jobs, and came to L.A., got a license, and put a private eye ad in the paper. He must have got a customer because he suddenly took that apartment under the name of Anson. And the next he knew, he got bumped off. Kind of a pathetic case.
Here's the ice.
Well, happy days.
Cheers.
What about Hench?
Nothing about Hench. He and the girl had been drinking for days. The world is full of bums like Hench.
What about the gun?
Well, it was the one killed Phillips. Killer must have taken Hench's gun with him.
You can trace that gun.
Hench doesn't even remember the number, just that it had a piece broken off the grip.
Well, thanks for the drink, Marlowe. I don't know what to make of you. I can't see you knowing as little as you pretend. How long do you expect to stay dummied up?
I don't know.
Well, let me help you out. Till noon tomorrow.
And after that?
Withholding evidence is a rap you won't beat. Let's go, Spangler.
Did you go through Phillips's desk?
Yeah, nothing there. Just a diary full of ordinary stuff, except it was hand-printed. Very neat. Must have been the way the guy wrote.
Oh, Marlowe.
You know any tall blondes?
I'd have to think. How tall?
Tall. A looker. She came out of the place about an hour before you got there.
Nothing comes to me.
Well, talk things over with your client and then come clean, Marlowe. Noon. Tomorrow. 12 hours.
I don't think we can believe a word he says.
Oh, he just changed the name. It wasn't Cassidy.
But you remember it.
Yeah. Good night, Marlowe.
Good night.
Marlowe.
All right, talk it up, whoever you are.
Maybe you're smart. Maybe you'd like to do yourself some good.
How much good?
Say, $500 worth. Want to talk?
Who to?
Marnie, Idle Valley Club.
Who are you?
Just ask at the gate for Eddie Prue.
The club looked like a high-budget musical. A lot of glitter, a lot of scenery, and a plot with all the originality of a split fingernail. A blonde in a dress that looked like seawater sifted over with gold dust hung on the leer of a short, fat man. A cigarette girl had an egret plume in her hair, enough clothes to hide behind a toothpick, and one beautiful naked leg painted silver and the other gold. She had the disdainful expression of a dame who makes her dates by long distance. In the bar, quiet voices whispered of love, or 10%, or whatever they whisper about in such places. I sat in the bar to wait and listened to a man tell his girl that that was Linda Conquest who was back with the band.
Marlowe?
Huh?
I'm Eddie Prue.
Yeah. You want to talk to me, and I want to talk to you, and I want to talk to the girl who just sang.
Let's go. Mr. Marnie is waiting for you.
Marlowe, I don't like peepers. I don't like them for lots of reasons. I don't like them when they bother my friends, or bust in on my wife, or get tough with my guests. In short, I just don't like them. But just at this moment, I might have a use for you.
Is that why you had your hard boy here calling me up and trying to scare me to death, and then talking about $500?
Maybe.
Well, maybe our business is a little mixed up together, through no fault of mine.
In what way?
The description of this same hard boy fits a tall guy who was following around after a fellow in my business who happened to get shot this afternoon.
Who was the fellow?
Name of Phillips.
I don't know who killed him. Do you?
It may have been a tall blonde.
What? What blonde?
We don't know.
We?
Me and the cops.
You told the cops?
Very little. I found him. Look, Marnie, you know I'm trying to find Mrs. Leslie Murdoch. She's back singing here. I'd like to talk to her.
You can go to hell anytime you want to. Or do a job for me. Either way, you leave Eddie and me out of any conversations you might have with the police.
What's the job?
You were at my house. You saw my wife and her friend, Lou Vanier.
I don't do that kind of business.
Marlowe, I'll be straight with you. I've only been married 8 months. She's a swell girl, and she knows what time it is as a rule. She's just playing a wrong number at the moment.
Wrong in what way?
That's what I want you to find out. This fell out of Vanier's pocket here about 10 days ago.
Is this supposed to mean something to me?
You're the smart detective. You find out.
Well, this is a bill for dental supplies to a dental mechanic called Tiger.
I don't know what connection Vanier has with Tiger, but Vanier's up to something. Here's the 500. Take Vanier out of my wife's life, and there'll be another. Huh? I don't want to know how you do it. Just do it.
Pay me when I deliver, and let me talk to Linda Conquest.
Eddie, bring her in.
Sure, boss.
Tell me something else. Why was Prue following Phillips?
He was following my wife. But leave her out of it. I don't know who killed the guy.
Why should I believe you? Why did you have Prue call up and give me the shakes?
Leslie Murdoch was here today. He told Linda you were hired by his mother. I guess I'm just a fellow who likes his friends and doesn't want them bothered. Linda, this is Philip Marlowe. I'll leave you two alone, huh?
By and large, I'm sure I won't like you, so speak your piece and drift away.
What I like about this place is how it all runs true to type. The B picture, even down to the tall, dark torture with the negligent sneer.
Why do you want to talk to me?
She wants it back.
What?
The brassier doubloon you stole from her.
She thinks I stole it. She's a dirty old liar. What would I want with some silly old coin?
Money. I gather Mrs. Murdoch was not too generous.
No, she would not rate as generous.
Passing on from that to more important matters, will you give Leslie a divorce?
$25,000? I should be glad to.
So you're not in love with the guy?
You're breaking my heart.
He's in love with you, and you did marry him.
Mister, don't think I didn't pay for that mistake. Not a girl has to live, and it isn't always as easy as it looks. I don't want to be too cynical, but you'd be surprised how many girls marry to find a home. Especially girls whose arm muscles are all tired out fighting off the kind of optimists that come into these gin and glitter joints.
You got a home, but you gave it up.
You've met that poor sodden old dame.
I have.
You notice what she's doing to that kid, Merle? That girl had a shock of some kind. And the old brute has used that to dominate the kid's whole life. In company, she yells at her. But in private, she's apt to be stroking her hair, whispering in her ear, and the kid sort of shivers.
What sort of shock?
I don't know. Kid's in love with Leslie, but emotionally she's about 10 years old. Something funny's gonna happen in that family. I'm glad I won't be there.
You're tough, and you're wise, Linda. I suppose when you married him, you thought you could get your hands on plenty.
I thought at least it would be a vacation. That Murdoch woman is ruthless, Marlowe. She's up to something. You watch your step.
Would she kill a couple of men?
I don't get it.
Two men are dead and connected with the brasher doubloon.
You're making that up.
I believe you didn't take it, Linda. What about the divorce?
That's none of your affair.
I agree. Thanks for talking to me. Do you know a fellow named Vanier?
He's a friend of Lois. One of these days, it's apt to turn out to be a small, quiet funeral. Mourning will kill him.
Why? Lois' magic flops at the drop of a hat. Anybody can see that.
Vanier isn't just anybody. He's in a lot of things. He even knows Mrs. Murdoch.
Oh? How?
He used to call regularly on the phone. He'd always talk to Merle. That's all I know. Marlowe, I'm tired. Please go away.
Linda, good night and thanks. Good luck.
Yeah.
Good morning, Mrs. Murdoch. The cops are after me.
I thought you were more competent than that.
When I left you yesterday, a man followed me. I invited him to tell me why. We arranged to meet. But when I got there, he was dead on the floor of his bathroom. Name of George Phillips?
I have never heard of him. And now the police are involved over this dead man?
Naturally. And they want to know why I'm involved. How's your asthma?
Bad. Get on with your story.
Remember Morningstar? When you told me the doubloon had been returned to you, I tried to contact him to say any deal was off. When I got there, he was dead, on the floor of his office. I called the hospital, but I did not give my name.
That was wise of you.
Was it? I don't think I'd call it wise. I want to be nice, Mrs. Murdoch. I think you understand that in your rough way, but two murders happened. Both bodies were found by me, and both are connected with your coin. You take all this very calmly.
What do you want me to do?
The coin was returned to you?
Yesterday.
Mrs. Murdoch, I have until noon today to reveal the name of my client.
That would be a breach of confidence.
I wish you'd leave the damn port alone and try to make some effort to understand the position.
You'll find a way out. I expect it to cost me a little more money, of course.
Excuse me while I try to breathe. Let me explain. I'm working for you this week. Next week it'll be somebody else, I hope, and so on and on it will go. And to do that, I need to be on reasonably good terms with the police. I have to tell them my connection with Phillips, and they have to question anybody they want to question. Can't you understand that?
Doesn't the law give you the right to protect a client? If it doesn't, what is the use of anyone hiring a detective?
The law is a matter of give and take. Even if I had the right to refuse to talk, it would be the end of my business. I value your custom, Mrs. Murdoch, but not enough to cut my throat and bleed in your lap.
You seem to have made a nice mess of the whole thing. You didn't find my daughter-in-law, and I got the doubloon back myself. All you did was find a couple of dead men that I have nothing to do with. And now you want me to tell the police all my private business in order to protect you from your own incompetence. If I am wrong, pray correct me.
Well, nobody's perfect. But you can't dummy up on a murder case. You can't fob cops off. As long as they think you are hiding something, they never let up. Give them a reasonable and plausible story, and they go away cheerful. And the most reasonable and plausible story is always the truth. They won't publish it in the papers. Do you have any objection to telling it?
It doesn't seem to make much difference. Do I have to tell them that the coin has been returned, and how?
That's the sort of truth I had in mind.
This is going to humiliate me very much.
Too bad.
You're a callous brute. I deeply regret ever having met you.
Mutual.
Merle.
Yes, Mrs. Murdoch?
Ask my son to come in here at once, and you come with him. My son took the coin, Mr. Marlowe. My son. My own son.
And he returned it?
I only have one coin. There is only one coin.
Oh, I was forgetting.
Sit down, Merle. Yes. And you too, Leslie.
Yes, Mother.
Now, tell Mr. Marlowe about the doubloon.
Oh, but I...
I'm afraid he has to be told.
Well... you know I owe Alex Morney $12,000. I didn't want Mother to know, and he was pressing me pretty hard for payment. I guess I knew I would have to tell Mother in the end, but I was weak enough to want to put it off. So I took the doubloon one afternoon. Morney agreed to hold it as security, as a pledge. When the dealer called up and asked about the coin, I immediately became suspicious that Morney was trying to sell it. I was badly scared. When Merle told me that Mother had employed a detective... Merle ought not to have told me, but Mother has promised not to scold her for it. I was sure you were hired to find the doubloon, not Linda. I knew where Linda was. So, yesterday I went to Morney. At first he laughed in my face. But when I told him the terms of the will, how it couldn't be sold, he just gave it back to me without another word. So I brought it home and told Mother all about it.
Thank you. You, Leslie. That's all, Mr. Marlowe.
Hmm. Did Morney threaten you?
No, he was very decent about it, really.
This was at the Idle Valley Club? Was Eddie Prue there?
Who is Eddie Prue?
Morney's bodyguard. I didn't waste all my time yesterday.
He wasn't around.
And the coin is here, in the house, now?
Where else would you expect it to be? Kiss your mother now, Leslie, and run along.
Yes, Mother. See you later.
Merle.
Yes?
Go back to your work. I wanted you to hear this. But if I ever catch you violating my confidence, you know what will happen.
Oh, I never will, Mrs. Murdoch. Never. You can trust me.
I hope so. Get out.
Yes.
I'm very fond of my son. This grieves me deeply. Will he have to tell his story to the police?
I hope not. They won't believe it.
What?
Did he make it up himself, or did you teach it to him? You want me to believe a big fish like Morney would tie himself to a couple of small murders over a gambling pledge?
I don't like your tone, Mr. Marlowe.
I don't blame you. I don't like it myself. I don't like you, or this case, or the truth I'm not told, or the lies I am
told. Get out! Get out of this house at once! Don't delay one instant! Get out!
I'll be glad to.
Mr. Marlowe! Oh, Mr. Marlowe, please wait.
The hell with her.
Please, she's in trouble. She needs you.
You're wearing lipstick, Merle. Looks good.
Please, please help her. I know she blusters, but her heart is pure gold.
It's a forgery. To hell with her. No. I'm in trouble up to my ear flaps, and I've run out of time.
Oh, please.
Oh, now don't you start crying.
Don't touch me. Don't ever touch me.
Merle, did something happen to you when you were younger? A man scared you or something like that? Well, look, I won't do anything that will scare you. Not ever. Nor will Leslie, nor the old wine barrel. She's decent enough to you, isn't she?
Yes.
Sure. Now, why don't you get over it? Is he still around, the one that hurt you?
He's dead. He fell out of a... Mrs. Murdoch keeps telling me to forget it. She talks to me for the longest time, telling me to forget it, but I just can't.
I'll bet.
Mrs. Murdoch can't forget it either. You see, he was her first husband. I was his secretary. Mr. Bright fell out of a window.
I said I'd give you till noon, Marlowe.
I had to go to the dentist.
Till 2 p.m.?
I left a message for you.
Had a busy little morning?
You boys are as cute as a couple of lost golf balls.
You think he's sweating, Spangler?
He should be.
You know, a reporter once wrote that when you pass beyond the green lights of the precinct station, you pass clear out of this world into a place beyond the law.
He wants us to come back to Earth.
Well, what's up with you two?
Hench confessed.
Yeah, he confessed.
What did you use on him, a pickaxe?
No. Look, you want to know or you just want a wisecrack?
Tell me.
Well, Hench was drunk when we brought him in, right? A guy like that, you take his liquor away, he's a lost cuckoo. Well, last night in the cells, Hench is bugs, so they drag him over to the hospital ward and they shoot him full of hop. Now, that's between us. No hop on the record, you get it?
All too clearly.
Well, this A.M., he's fine. Pale, but peaceful. So we go over and we treat him nice. You know the line.
Yeah.
So after a while, he opens his trap just enough to say Palermo. Now, it turns out this Palermo owns property, including the apartment house on Court Street. And he's important. He gets the vote out up there. Well, we come back to the hutch and we phone Palermo. We talk like this. Hench wants to see you, Mr. Palermo. I wouldn't know why. He's a poor guy, says Palermo. A nicer guy. I think he's okay. So he's a want to see me? That's a fine. I see him. I see him alone, without any coppers. We say, okay, Mr. Palermo. So Palermo comes down and he talks to Hench. And after a while, Palermo comes out and he says, okay, copper. He make it to confess. I pay the lawyer, maybe. I like it, the poor guy. And he goes away.
What was the story?
Well, like this. Phillips made a pass at Hench's girl 2 days before out in the hall. Now, Hench saw it, and he got the brooding, the way a drunk will brood. So yesterday, he tells the girl to go for a walk, and he knocks on Phillips' door. He gets in and starts telling Phillips how he feels and what he's going to do. Phillips gets scared and pulls a gun. Hench hits him, then drags him into the bathroom and gives him the business with the gun. You like it?
Love it.
Then Hench takes Phillips' gun, puts it under his pillow, and ditches his own. He won't tell us where.
Oh, that's a lovely touch. Putting the gun under his pillow. I'd never in the world have thought of that.
Well, look at it this way. Hench was smart. The way he did it got us thinking he was a harmless drunk who went out and left his door open and had a gun ditched on him.
Well, if he was going to confess anyway, it doesn't make much difference. Will he cop a plea?
Well, I figure Palermo could get him off with manslaughter.
Why would Palermo want to get him off with anything?
He likes Hench.
And Palermo's a guy we can't push around.
What about the girl?
Well, she won't say a word. We can't do anything to her.
A nice, neat little job all around.
Well, you wouldn't kick, would you? Whatever is your business can stay your business, you get me? Not that I wouldn't like to hear your story, but, well, I don't figure I have an absolute right to insist the way things are.
That's white of you, Breeze. And you too, Spangler. A lot of good things in life to both of you. Goodbye. I went to see Palermo. He turned out to be a good family man, beside getting the vote out. It seemed he had a brother who was, as he put it, a bad brother. And the brother was trying to live a very quiet life in that same apartment house. It was not so good for this bad brother to have cops fill the joint up investigating things. So Palermo had made Hench a proposition. Confess, take the heat off, let the brother slip away, then in court say, to hell with the confession, I was drunk. Then Palermo's lawyer would get him off, the cops would be stuck, and then everybody would forget all about it. And the killing of George Phillips would be just another unsolved crime. And then Mr. Palermo smiled and shook my hand with his fine, strong, warm hand and wished me luck, knowing all the time that if I went down to headquarters and told the boys, they would laugh at me, and I would have to laugh with them. Eighth floor, Pop.
What's cooking?
Huh?
You've got a gray suit on today.
So I have.
Looks nice. I liked that blue one you was wearing yesterday, too.
Go on, give out.
You rode up to 8 yesterday, twice. Second time was late. And after that, the boys in blue come bustling in to find old Morningstar cold.
Any of them up there now?
I didn't tell them nothing. Too late to mention it now, anyway. They'd eat my ass off.
Why?
Why I'd have told them. The hell with them. You talk to me civil, and damn few people do that.
The name's Marlowe.
Just call me Pop. Who killed him?
I don't know. Did you notice anybody going up there or coming down?
Nope. Well, they could have used the fire stairs.
Pop, could you use a $5 bill? Not as a bribe in any sense, but as a token of esteem from a sincere friend?
Son, I could use a $5 so fast it would shave the whiskers off the picture of Abe Lincoln. Thanks. That's right nice of you.
Pop, before I waste my time, do you know there's a guy in this corridor called Tiger Inn?
Gone. Carried 2 suitcases. Mostly carries just 1. I figure he picks up and delivers his work.
What work?
Such as making teeth that don't fit for poor old bastards like me. He's a dental technician.
Yeah, I've got a bill for him for some supplies. I looked up his address in the phone book. Some coincidence.
What's he done?
Some gold inlays, maybe. I think most likely he's taken a cruise to nowhere.
I'd shift places with him. Even if he only got to Frisco and got pinched there, I'd shift places with him.
Take me down, Pop.
Okay.
I drove all the way out to Teager's home, but he had skipped. So I drove all the way back to the office. I poured a drink. Another day was drawing to its end. The air dull and tired. The day's mail had 4 advertisements, 2 bills, and a begging letter. Nobody came in, nobody called, nothing happened. Nobody cared whether I lived or died or went to El Paso. Then a call came from the manager of my apartment block saying there was a very hysterical girl on my doorstep. Her name was Merle Davis. I got there fast. Merle. Merle, what is it? You can tell me. I won't hurt you.
I've been over to Mr. Vanier's house.
Vanier?
He lives at the end of Escamillo Drive.
Oh.
Yeah. It's very quiet there. Mr. Vanier's been living there for 3 years now.
How long have you known Vanier?
8 years. I don't know him very well. I have to take a parcel now and then. I never liked him. I was afraid he... I was afraid he...
But he didn't.
He had his pajamas on.
In the afternoon? Easy life. Some guys have all the luck.
You have to know something secret to make people pay you money.
Mm-hmm. How much money did you take to him today?
Only $500. Mrs. Murdoch said it would have to stop. Mr. Vanier would always promise to stop, but he never did, so... I did it. It was all my fault, and Mrs. Murdoch has been so wonderful to me. It couldn't make me any worse than I was already. You see, he was staring at me. He didn't even get up to let me in. There was a key left in the front door, so...
You went in?
I went over quite close to him sitting there, so I couldn't miss. I don't remember hearing the noise of the gun.
Didn't Vanier do anything?
No. He just leered, sort of. I didn't like to go back to Mrs. Murdoch and make more trouble for her, so I came here. I knew you would know what to do.
Sure. Merle, what did you touch in the house? Can you remember?
I put the light out, the lamp. I put it out.
What time was this?
Just before I came here.
It takes an hour to get here. The light was on in the afternoon?
I put the light out.
Merle, would you care for a drink?
Oh, no. I never drink anything at all.
Would you mind if I had one?
Why should I?
Thank you. I needed a drink. Her eyes were quite mad, and no matter how she tried, a regular spasm would twist up her head and face. I don't think she saw me sneak her handbag out into the kitchen with me. Her little Colt 25 was inside. I broke it open. It had a cartridge in the breech, but it was the wrong size. Somebody had jammed it in there long ago so that the gun could not be fired. When I went back, she had fainted clean away. So I called a doctor friend of mine to take care of her. Then I headed for Escamillo Drive. The key was still in the lock. I switched the light on. Vanier wore yellow pajamas and a green silk robe. He was leering all right. He was dead. He sat in a chair by the fireplace with a hole in the right side of his head and a .32 revolver on the carpet by his dangling right arm. So now I had found three murders and had no explanation for any of them. The setup here could be suicide, but I didn't believe it. I looked around. The picture that had fallen off the wall beside him was the clue to how it happened. Somebody had been standing to his right, somebody he didn't fear, and they had pulled a gun and shot him in the right temple. And then, startled by the blood and the recoil, the killer had jumped back and knocked the picture down. It was a reproduction of a guy in doublet and hose leaning out of a high window. A high window? A man leaning out? A long time ago? Vanier had a sense of humor. Hidden in the back of the picture was a list of payments going back 8 years, mostly for $500, and an envelope with a negative and a print showing a man leaning far out of a window with his mouth open, yelling. There was a woman's face behind his shoulder. For a long time, it looked to me as if the man was leaning out with his hands on the brick edges of the window. But then I saw it. The hands were not touching anything. He was not leaning. He was falling. Everything was falling into place. The gun beside Vanier had a piece broken off the checked rubber grip. I wiped it and took his bone-stiff hand and pressed his prints onto it. They wouldn't be too good, but they would have to do. I had to be sure they were the only ones. Once again, I walked out on a dead man and didn't call the police. I felt very tired, but there was still a lot to do. Merle?
Hmm.
Merle?
Hello.
Hello.
I'm all right. I'm fine, aren't I?
Sure.
Is this your bed I'm in?
Well, that's all right. There's a nurse outside.
I'm not afraid.
Thank you. I guess that's a compliment.
I lied to you. I didn't shoot anybody.
I know. Forget it.
Does Mrs. Murdoch know where I am?
Not yet.
Will you tell her everything?
I have to.
She'll understand. She knows the awful thing I did 8 years ago.
That's why she was paying Vanier?
I wish you hadn't had to know. Even my parents never knew.
Where are your parents, Merle?
Wichita. I haven't seen them for years.
What does your father do?
He's a vet. I want to tell you... I want to tell you all about it.
I know it all, Merle. Marlowe knows everything, except how to find a decent life. I'll take you back to Wichita tomorrow, Merle, to visit your parents at Mrs. Murdoch's expense.
Oh, well, that's wonderful of her.
Yeah. You go to sleep. I'm going to see her now. As soon as I visit a pawn shop to redeem a coin, You go to sleep.
Good night, Marlowe.
Mr. Marlowe, I made a mistake calling you in the first place. I have a feeling that you're going to be insolent again.
Just frank. I think you got value out of me, Mrs. Murdoch. But what did you get from Vanier? He's been blackmailing you for 8 years, hasn't he? On account of something that happened on the 26th of April, 1933?
Well?
Merle was Horace Bright's secretary. He was your first husband. She was a timid, old-fashioned girl. I figure he got high one time and made a pass at her and scared her out of her socks. She brooded on it, and then she got a chance and passed right back at him while he was leaning out of a window. Anything in that?
Speak plainly, Mr. Marlowe. I can stand plain talk.
How plain do you want it? She pushed her employer out of a window, murdered him in two words, and got away with it, with your help. Did Vanier just happen to see it, or did he have evidence?
He talked of a photograph, but I never saw it. I never believed it existed.
You paid out because you were so fond of Merle.
$11,100.
Pretty damn nice of you, Mrs. Murdoch, considering everything.
It was my husband's fault. He was vile. I can't blame her. She had blamed herself enough.
Well, it's over now. Vanier is through.
What? How?
Merle is at my place. She has a gun in her bag. She told me she shot Vanier. Well, he's dead, all right, but she didn't do it. He was dead long before she went there.
How is she?
I got her a doctor. Then I phoned her father. He wants her to come home.
Who killed Vanier?
Looks like suicide.
Men like Vanier don't commit suicide.
That's like saying girls like Merle don't push people out of windows. I'm going to take her home to Wichita. I'll need the $500 she was carrying for Vanier.
And how much more?
You believe what you want of me, Mrs. Murdoch. Just send her stuff. You don't need Merle anymore. The case will never be reopened. You know what I mean?
I understand. Goodbye, Mr. Marlowe.
Oh, one more thing. Is there anything about the doubloon in your collection to identify it from any other Brasher doubloon?
The coin maker's initials, EB, are on the left wing of the eagle. They're usually on the right.
And you did get it back?
I have told you so repeatedly. Go away, Mr. Marlowe. You bore me unspeakably.
Why, Leslie, hello. Just happened to be outside the door, did you? Come here. I want to talk to you.
I have nothing to say to you.
I think you have. Know a man named Vanier?
Vaguely.
Let me show you something. What do you think this is?
The Brasher doubloon.
This was sent to me by a would-be detective. A simple sort of fellow who got into a bad spot. He was hired to peddle this coin. Or the one upstairs. Whichever is the counterfeit.
Counterfeit?
Oh, I'm tired, Leslie. Let's not dance around, huh? Vanier and a man named Teager had an idea. Teager was a dental technician, so he could do gold inlays. So why not reproduce a rare and valuable gold coin? You nearly told the truth, didn't you?
Did I?
You did have gambling debts. You did take your mother's coin, but you didn't give it to Morney. You gave it to Vanier. But then Vanier needed to know if the counterfeit would stand up to inspection. So Teager suggests a coin dealer in his office building. Enter the tall blonde.
Who is she?
Lois Magic. Vanier got her to pose as an injured wife and hire a sucker for him, poor fat George Phillips, to try to sell the counterfeit coin. But old Morningstar was a sharp old bird, and he spotted the initials were on the wrong wing of the eagle. So he called your mother. She found the coin was missing. She hired me. You were scared.
I told you everything when I came to see you.
You were more scared after you saw me. You asked Vanier for the coin back. He gave you one. But now, Morningstar is suspicious. I have been hired, and you are scared, and he sees his nice idea in danger. So now, we come to murder.
I didn't do them.
No, Vanier did. He went to talk to George Phillips. To ask him what the hell he did to stir things up so much. Maybe poor George let slip he'd contacted me because Vanier shot him. Then he looked for the coin, but he didn't find it. It's this one. George Phillips had already posted it to me. Vanier is bound to think Morningstar had it, so he cracks the old man's skull, but is still empty-handed. By now, he is very annoyed. But he can't touch you.
Why?
Because it would break his hold on your mother. If he hurt you, she wouldn't care what happened.
What is this to do with my mother?
Don't kid me any more than you have to. I know all about the blackmail. Did you kill Vanier?
Is this one of those scenes where after the suspect listens to the master detective's brilliant analysis, he makes his world-weary pounce on the least promising? What do I do now? Turn pale as paper, froth at the mouth, and pull a gun out of my right ear?
You could try.
I left my gun upstairs.
He had a big hold on you already, but he must have wanted it still stronger. So last night he told you the whole blackmail story, didn't he?
Yes. He was gloating almost. After all, Marlowe, she is my mother.
Nobody can take that away from you.
He had a gun in the pocket of his robe. I somehow snatched it away from him, held it to his head to scare him. It went off. I jumped back, knocked a picture down. It was an accident.
Why not make it a nice, clean, honest murder?
It's what happened. I put his prints on the gun and left it beside him. What about the police?
Now, that gun belonged to a man named Hench, so it ties Vanier to Phillips. The cops may never think of you. On the other hand, if you told an honest story, no jury would convict you. Juries don't like blackmailers.
But I didn't know anything about the blackmail before last night. Vanya just showed me a way to make some easy money.
Well, at least you're honest, Leslie. And we're sure the only prints on that gun are Vanya's. I did them again myself.
You mean the police will think it was suicide?
Well, if they're satisfied he did the other killings, yeah.
Then you'll let me get away with it?
Get away with what? Maybe it was an accident, like you say. I'm not a cop or an informer. I've been working for your mother, and whatever right to my silence that gives her, she can have. I don't like this damn family, and I don't like what it's done to Merle. So, I'm going to take her home.
I don't know how to thank you. A man I hardly know, taking risks for me.
I'm going the way I always go, and with the heartfelt hope that I won't be seeing you in the fishbowl. I'm going to pat your little painted nigger on the head on the way out and go buy a pint of good liquor and drink enough of it to stop me thinking and then sleep, I hope. And then drive Merle back to Wichita. How are you, Merle?
Oh, I'm much better. How are you?
Pass me those dark glasses, will you? I'm bleeding to death.
Oh, yeah. Here they are. Oh, I'm sorry. I've been a terrible nuisance.
Nonsense. Your father and mother are dying to see you.
Oh, it's very kind of Mrs. Murdoch to let me go.
Yeah.
You're not angry with me?
No. I'm just a little slow this morning.
Last night I meant...
Get it over with. I'm not driving halfway across the USA with a nervous breakdown in the seat beside me.
Well, last night...
You said you killed Vanier, then you said you didn't. You didn't. He was dead when you got there with the money for Mrs. Murdoch.
No, for me. It was her money, of course, but it was for me because of what I did. Oh, I owe her so much. Of course, she doesn't give me much salary, but I could never repay her.
It would take the Yankees baseball team with two bats each to give her what she has coming from you. You didn't push Horace Bright out of any window.
Oh no, I
wouldn't be telling you this if the doctor hadn't said it would be all right. Face reality, Merle. Maybe you had the impulse to kill Horace Bright, but it's not in your nature. Maybe you fainted and he did fall. But it was Mrs. Elizabeth Bright Murdoch who heaved him over for his life insurance, among other reasons.
Oh, that's impossible. Mrs. Murdoch protected me. I did it. I don't remember very well, but
she made you think you had done it. Here, look in this envelope. Look at that picture Vanier took.
That's Mr. Bright. And that's Mrs. Murdoch behind him. He looks mad.
If he looks mad there, you should have seen him when he bounced. He's screaming with fear. Look at the position of his hands.
What?
They're holding air. That is old Mrs. M giving her first husband the heave-ho. Don't you get it? Vanier was blackmailing her.
Oh, but Mrs. Murdoch has always been so lovely to me.
She made you the goat. She's smart and she's patient. I have to hand it to her. I'd like to hand it to her with an elephant gun, but my polite breeding restrains me. Do you understand now?
You must never show this picture to Mrs. Murdoch. It would upset her terribly.
Merle? Oh, I don't know. Maybe you're disappointed you didn't kill somebody. You just stay in Wichita and forget all about Mrs. Murdoch. You won't be seeing her again. Let me tie up all the loose ends. Now, you forget all of this. Forget me.
Oh, I couldn't forget you, Mr. Marlowe.
Okay, don't forget me, Merle. Lieutenant Jesse Breeze never believed Hench's confession. He just wanted to put the squeeze on me. He knew I couldn't keep quiet if I had proof that Hench didn't do it. So now he had it solved to his own satisfaction. Suicide by Vanier after he'd done the two murders. Teeger was arrested in Salt Lake City with a suitcase full of counterfeit doubloons. He never knew where Vanier got the original, and nobody came forward to say they'd lost one. Hench turned out to be wanted for liquor store holdups with an Italian who was never found. It was also never established if the Italian was related to Palermo, who got the vote out. I went home and mixed a drink or two, or nine, and played over a few chess games. I played over a Capablanca that went 59 moves of beautiful, cold, remorseless chess, almost creepy in its silent implacability. Me and Capablanca. Like that.
In Bill Morrison's radio adaptation of Raymond Chandler's novel, The High Window, Ed Bishop played the part of Philip Marlowe, Toby Robbins that of Merle, and Tucker McGuire, Mrs. Murdoch. Leslie Murdoch was played by Peter Marinker, Lieutenant Breeze, Paul Maxwell, Alex Morney, David Healey, Mr. Morningstar, Don Fellows, Linda Conquest, Margaret Robertson, George Phillips, Bill Morrison, Lou Vanier, Blain Fairman, Lois Magic, Nicolette McKenzie, Pop, Ramsay Williams, Hench, Paul Meier, Doll, Elizabeth Bell, Shifty and Spangler, Rod Beacham, Apartment Manager, Gavin Campbell, and Eddie Prue, Malcolm Gerard. The music consultant was Adrian Edwards. The play was directed by John Tydeman.
Next week, Marlowe is led on a manhunt deep into the gritty underworld of Hollywood in The Little Sister.
BBC Radio 7 on DAB Digital Radio, on digital TV and online.
Hello from me, Jim Lee. It's 4 o'clock in the early hours of Sunday here on 7. And on the way in a moment, Paul Jackson meets the original Godfather, alias Dennis Norden. We'll be reminiscing about My Word, Take It From Here, and 60 years of comedy writing. And in an hour, we explore the ties, friendships, and loneliness of a family living in a small Midlands village in Susan Hill's Gentlemen and Ladies. So now, Dennis Norden talks to Paul Jackson about comedy writing, the carpentry skills of Frank Muir, and the nightmares of turning up for a My Word recording session with nothing to say. For the next hour here on Radio 7, you're in the company of the original Godfather.
Nowadays, Frank Muir and Dennis Norden tend to be remembered for their collaboration on My Word and My Music, which ran for 36 years. Or maybe it's for Frank's appearances on Call My Bluff. Or is it Dennis's stewardship of It'll Be All Right on the Night over the past 30 years? As such, they are in danger of being perceived forever as fine stalwarts of a bygone age of comedy and popular entertainment. But for me, their contribution goes so much deeper. When we look back at the very start of British broadcast comedy, we all rightly remember the legacy of Hancock, of writers like Gault and Simpson, or later Clement and Lafrenet. But the part that Frank Muir and Dennis Norden played in creating the atmosphere in which these talents could prosper is by and large overlooked.
My gosh, what we owe
all of us owe to them is extraordinary.
They were the first.
They were the godfathers. They were the ones who started it all.
This is the BBC Home Service.
I described it to Frank once as the source.
Like a breath of fresh air.
Their normality was unique.
What they were, they exuded class.
That's right, you'd hear it on the radio. Script by Frank Meier and Dennis Norton.
Absolutely. It was listening to the radio as kids.
Now, when I say class, I don't mean class distinction. I mean quality. Quality.
The greatest thing on God's earth. It was beautifully written.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's bedtime with Braden.
The most beautiful girl in the world. Eats my candy, drinks my brandy.
They were like Fulton and Mason's compared with Lyons Corner House.
It really changed my life.
And the thought of actually me being in television or radio one day in my adult life would just never occur to me.
Do you know, I mean, there was something that I used to write down to the lowest common denominator. And we desperately wanted to follow in their footsteps in that respect, you know.
They were very purposeful, quite dedicated, and always completely engrossed in their work.
They also looked extremely urbane and successful. They wore bow ties.
They always wore ties and suits.
And pinstripe shirts, and I'm sure they went and had lunch.
I disliked them intensely when I met them.
You know, I had lunch and used cigarette holders.
When I really met them, I saw straight away they were taller than us.
And I'm sure they braced for dinner.
I thought, well, I could live with not being the best writer in the country, I mean, for comedy, but I thought we were assured to be the tallest.
Because that was your kind of USP, Alan, really, the tallest.
Well, indeed, we were the tallest and the youngest. That was the accolade that they gave us, the boys, who we referred to.
I am, by the way, the greatest fan.
I spotted. No,
you spotted. You could guess.
Brenda Talbot, not just Muir and Norden's biggest fan, but also for some 30 years, the person who typed out more of their handwritten scripts than anyone else. And before her were Alan Simpson, Ray Galton, Ian Lefrene, Dick Clement, Dick Vosborough and Eric Sykes. Comedy writers, and certainly for me, comedy heroes, every one of them. Earlier, I went to speak to Dennis in his third floor Eyrie in the heart of London's West End, where he's now preparing to write his memoirs.
Dennis, what was it that made you think being funny or writing funny might be a career? I mean, did you go to the music halls? Did you listen to anything on the radio before the war? Was the comedy on the radio before the war?
I have been thinking back on that. One wasn't conscious of there being a lot of comedy. For me, radio was, you know, the children's hours and things like right. that, but the plays by people with magnificent names like El Dugard Peach. And there was comedy, but it was of a very genteel, restrained type, more a magazine that used to be called The Humorist than even Punch. Punch would have been like Viz to BBC of that day.
So Itmar really, which of course was partly a response to the war situation.
Holiday!
And that was really the first, if I got that right, Dennis, was that the first time?
Yes, Itmar was the first, as it were, unifying radio comedy.
Now, I want your help, Mrs. Mott. Now, are you good with sailors?
Oh, I love them, sir! Bless their bell bottom!
It was what television calls event radio. People were in the next mornings in after the blitzes and things like that would say, did you hear Itmar last night?
DTFN!
NLYSLDDTH.
What's that, sir?
Never let your sea legs dangle down the hatch.
So that, I suppose.